Good afternoon, everyone.
Good afternoon.
Welcome to the Reformed Church of Los Angeles. May the Lord be with you.
And also with you.
As we enter the fourth Sunday of the Advent season, may the love of God the Father and the grace of Jesus the Son and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be and abide with us all.
Amen.
Show us your unfailing love, O God, our Savior.
And grant us your salvation.
Listen to what the Lord our God says.
He promises peace to his people who are his beloved saints.
The Lord will indeed give what is good.
Righteousness goes before him and prepares the way for his steps.
May the Lord make his holy face shine upon us in this time of heaven worship. May we see God's face and so know peace.
Amen.
Please join me in a word of prayer. God of power and mercy, you call us once again to celebrate the coming of your Son. Remove those things that hinder love of you, that when he comes, he may find us waiting in awe and wonder for him, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever.
Amen.
Now we're going to do the Advent candle. Prepare the way of the Lord. We light this candle in peace, the peace that Jesus, our Savior, gives to the world.
Prepare then the way of the Lord.
Good afternoon, RCLA.
Good afternoon.
Shall we all stand together this afternoon? If you're here for the first time, we'd like to greet you and welcome you in the name of our Jesus, our Christ, our Lord, this afternoon. Before we start, I just want you to go ahead and turn to your neighbor and say, neighbor, I'm glad that you're in the house of the Lord this morning. I always like starting off like that. It's always nice to see your neighbor, love on your neighbor, greet your neighbor, and just feel, make them feel home, right? Because we're in the house of the Lord, and this is the place to be, amen? Psalm 27, 1-9, it says, clap your hands, all peoples, shout to God with the loud songs of joy, for the Lord the Most High is to be feared, a great king over all the earth. He has subdued peoples under us and nations under his feet. He chose a heritage for us, the pride of Jacob, whom he loves. God has gone with a shout, the Lord with the sound of a trumpet. Sing praises to God. Sing praises. Sing praises to our King. Sing praises. For God is the King of all the earth. Sing praises with a song. God reigns over the nation. God sits on his holy throne. The princes of the peoples gather as the people of God of Abraham. For the shields of the earth belong to God. He is highly exalted. Amen?
Amen.
So we're going to go ahead and, again, our brother's grabbing something. God is good. Something about reading the Psalms, when you start off your day with the Psalms, it just blesses your heart, you know, just to know that God is a holy God and he sits on his throne, and we have the opportunity to come together as a family to honor his name and to lift up that great name, amen?
Lord, it's good when you're born again.
7:28-29 says, "Then Jesus said, 'Come to me, all of you who are weary and carry heavy burdens, and I will give you rest. Take my yoke upon you. Let me teach you, because I am humble and gentle at heart, and you will find rest in your souls.'" He loves Emmanuel, we are. We long to feel that we
Family, it is Advent. It is a season in which we prepare our hearts to welcome Christ, who is the bringer of all peace. We confess to you the ways in which we block the peace of Christ in our life. We confess to you, O God of peace, the worry about the little details. We confess to you, O God of peace, the financial burdens we put upon ourselves. We confess to you, O God of peace, the impatience and the irritability we feel and take out on one another. We confess to you, O God of peace, the bickering and quarreling we get into because we are too busy. We confess to you, O God of peace, though we make ourselves less than peaceful at this time of year, your peace is always there for us. Instill within us your peace, O God. Instill within us your peace and help us to make choices that bring us closer to you. Help us be more peaceful, that we may spread the peace and love to others. Amen. Family, we now have the opportunity to come before our Lord and confess our sins. Please take a moment of silent confession before God and one another. Brothers and sisters, there is no condemnation for those who are in Christ. Your sins have been forgiven.
Good afternoon, family.
Good afternoon.
Next, we state our belief precisely through the historic words of the Apostles' Creed. Amen?
Amen.
Please join me. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, God's only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day he rose again. He ascended to heaven. He is seated at the right hand of the Father, and he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sin, the resurrection of the body, and life everlasting. Amen. And today we continue in our Westminster Shorter Catechism, and we've been going through an exposition of God's moral law, the Ten Commandments. And today we go into the seventh commandment. In question 70 this week, we ask the following question. What is the seventh commandment? And the answer is simple. The seventh commandment is, you shall not commit adultery. Now we know that marriage is between one man and one woman, and for them to be in union is the way God designed intimacy, sexual intimacy between couples. Now, Jesus takes this step further, and I won't get too much into that, but we can think it's just a physical act to commit adultery. You'll hear us dig into that more next week in the following, where he actually challenges it and says, you have heard it said, but I tell you, if you even look at a woman with lust in your eyes, you have committed adultery. So the sin is not just the action, it's also in our thoughts and in our hearts. Amen? Let us be ever vigilant of what our hearts are feeling and what our minds are thinking.
Good afternoon, everyone.
Good afternoon.
I want to welcome you to RCLA, the Reformed Church of Los Angeles. We're so glad that you're here to worship Christ with us today. If you're new or if you brought a guest with you, please stop by our welcome center at the entrance. We'd love to meet you. And if you can provide your contact information in the bulletin and place it in the offering basket, we'd really appreciate it. This bulletin is the best way to let us know what's going on with you. If you have a prayer request or a praise report, please write it in the bulletin and place it in the offering basket. We want to know how we can pray for you or how we can give God praise for you. If you're interested in serving, growing spiritually, or just getting connected, please let us know on the back of the bulletin as well. Place it in your offering basket. We'd really love like to get you connected. Men's group. You meet tomorrow evening at Café Canela in Plaza Mexico. All the men are invited to join them tomorrow evening at 7 p.m. for great coffee, good fellowship, and a really deep study. Bring a friend and bring your Bible. Youth group. Our next meeting will be on Saturday, December 28th in the upper room across the street from 2 to 4. This is for kids that are in junior high and high school. They will be having their end of the year party and food will be provided. But if you'd like to share a special treat, please sign up with one of the youth leaders. Remember to invite a friend and bring your Bible for a great time to learn about God and an awesome time to fellowship with each other. Family, a reminder that we will be having Christmas service Christmas morning at 10 a.m. Please invite your friends and family to come and share the celebration that our Savior was born. Hope to see you all here on Wednesday, December 25th at 10 a.m. Journey books. If you have a journey book and you still owe a balance, it is due. Please make sure to get your journey book balance paid by the end of the month. Family, Ephesians 4:32 reminds us of this. Be kind and compassionate to one another, forgiving one another just as God also forgave you in Christ. The grace and peace of our Lord Jesus Christ be with you all. Let us then greet one another as a sign of God's peace. Please stand, cross the aisle, and pass the peace of Christ. Try to start with somebody that you don't know. Father God, are to go downstairs for practice. If you are not in the Christmas play, please return to your seats. We now continue our time of worship with the giving of our tithes and offering. One of the surest ways to show God that we don't trust him is to be tight-fisted with what he's generously given us. We read the question asked in James 3, 11 through 12. Does a spring pour out sweet and bitter water from the same opening? Can a fig tree produce olives, my brothers and sisters, or a grapevine produce figs? Neither can a saltwater spring yield fresh water. Family, as followers of Christ, we are called to generosity. May we be true to that calling at all times. May we not confuse those around us by holding back from opportunities to give joyfully, generously, and sacrificially. May we always be consistent in providing for the Lord's church. If you have given electronically, there is a portion on the back of the bulletin to tear off and deposit in the offering basket. Please give as you are led.
My sermon title this morning is God With Us. God with us. Can I ask you to stand if you are able for the reading of God's word? That's Matthew chapter 1 and verse 23 says, "Behold, the virgin shall be with child and shall bear a son, and they shall call his name Emmanuel," which translated means God with us. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Join me in a word of prayer. Heavenly Father, we do come before you this fourth Sunday in the Advent season. Once again, giving you praise that we understand is inadequate, but nevertheless, Lord, we offer you our appreciation, as small as it may be, God, compared to what you really deserve. But we know that you accept it. And we ask, Father, that just as you have blessed us and shown us your Son Jesus in the past few weeks, pray that you continue to do that today. We ask, Lord, that your Spirit will fill this place and be our teacher, to illuminate our minds and burn in our hearts and grain in our hearts the truths that you want to tell us this afternoon. And Father, I pray for myself, I pray that the words of my mouth and the meditations of my heart find you pleasing in thy sight. I ask that you would forgive me my own imperfections, God, and this most holy task of preaching thy word. I thank you for the privilege, pray that you would give me unction to preach it. And most of all, I thank you for him in whose name I come. And all God's people said,
amen.
You may be seated. It's been well said that we need to stop asking for God's presence and start asking for more of his presence. Don't we love the presence of God when we're going through the battle, when we're going through difficulties and trials? We don't want to have to deal with trials and temptations and things of the such on our own. We want God to be with us. You know, I want to believe that all of us are in the business of moving forward, in the business of progressing, and in the business of bettering ourselves. However, I am also of the opinion that most people do not like the difficulties and challenges that come with such growth and such progress. It can be difficult, and we regret sometimes the fact that we just don't like to handle the pressure that comes with moving forward. It ain't easy to succeed. If it were, everyone would just be successful. Now, we are approaching a new year, and I know that a new year will bring new blessings, but I also am realistic, and I know that a new year will also bring new challenges. And there is a perpetual vulnerability with those people who wake up every morning and want to make themselves better, because they're always walking in new territory and unknown territory. And many other people, on the other hand, out of fear of the challenges we just spoke of, don't move a finger to move forward. As a matter of fact, they use God as an excuse to not progress in their lives. They say, well, if God wanted me to have this or to have that or to be in that position, he would just give it to me, or he would just put me there. Not true. Or other people say, well, I'm waiting for confirmation for the Lord before I can move forward. Yeah, well, you might be waiting for your whole life, because God doesn't promise you confirmation in every situation. Sometimes you just need to act. Others say, I don't feel peace about this. I need to feel the peace of the Holy Spirit. I need to feel God in this situation. I need to feel him. You need to feel God? What does he feel like? I've never felt him. See, you cannot use you cannot base your Christian walk on feelings. You cannot base your Christian walk on emotions. Your emotions are not a sure guide. You may not feel God's love, but it's there. You may not feel God's grace, but it's still there. It doesn't make a difference whether you feel anything or not. Or you might say, I may not want to do something because I feel like it's God telling me and convicting me that that's not the right thing, that's why I don't feel peace. Yeah? Or it could be the devil and your flesh telling you not to do it because that's exactly what God wants you to do. Too many Christians confuse their feelings with the Holy Spirit. That anxiety that you feel doesn't necessarily mean it's the Holy Spirit warning you of something. That bad feeling in your gut is not necessarily the Holy Spirit. It might just be the tacos you had last night. You need to base your decisions on what God says in His Word and not on how you feel. But Pastor, I don't know how to find God's will for my life. I hate that question. You want to know God's will for your life? Here's God's will for your life. Love God and do whatever you want. That's God's will for your life. Love Him and do whatever you feel like doing. If you love God, you're not going to do anything that breaks His law. And if it's in accordance with His Word, you don't need to ask God for permission to do it. Just do it. I don't know who this word is for, but I know that some of you, in fact, do need to hear it. You don't always need 100% clarity on an issue before you do something. Some of you just need to do something. Just do something. Mess it up. Fix it. It just shows that you have a pulse and that you're alive. Just do something. Now, don't hear what I'm not saying. Because there are some of you that are so active and so practical and so impatient that you never even acknowledge God in any single situation. You never pray and ask for God's blessing or spiritual guidance. You never consult God's word to see if something is right or if something is wrong. You never go to other Christians for input or advice on something, and the result is you walk yourself right out of God's will. So just staying busy all the time ain't the way to do it either. There's a balance that we need here. We need to understand God's responsibility in a matter, but we also need to understand our responsibility in a matter. Are you the person making the first mistake of not acknowledging God in your situation? Not recognizing Him in your midst? Are you not acknowledging that God actually is working in your situation right now, even if you don't feel it or see it? Just because He's not working in the same way that He did in the last situation, that does not mean that He's not working. You see, we like to put God in a little box, you know, a little box like this one right here. We like to put Him in there, and we want Him to work in the same way each and every single time, just like He did before. We say, God, I'm comfortable with this method, so don't you go changing things up on me now. As children of the Most High, we don't have that option. We don't have the option of choosing how God shows up or doesn't show up in a situation in our lives. Or are you the person who is paralyzed, not moving a muscle, because you think God is going to do it all, or you're waiting for some kind of sign in the sky to appear before you can make a move? I'm here to tell you that both positions are wrong, whether you are the one that is waiting for God to do something or show you something before you can move, or if you're the one that thinks you know it all already, and you never acknowledge God because of it. Now, know-it-alls are funny, because there's something about know-it-alls that at times they may progress a lot in natural matters, in physical life, but a lot of times they don't make advances in spiritual matters. What do I mean by that? I mean that they only operate in the arenas that they already know very well and are very, very comfortable. They never like to step out of that comfort zone. And so they look at the next person and say, well, at least I'm not confused like that person over there. Well, of course you're not. You've been in the same grade for like 10 years. You personally answer to the test. You've taken it like 100 times. Why don't you step out of that comfort zone and actually allow God to work in a new way to where you will actually need to depend on Him and trust Him for guidance, for dependence? How many of you are facing new challenges right now? One person? Okay, well, this message is for you. Now, what I want to tell you is this, that God will be with you in those challenges just as He was with you in the past. And He will be with you in this coming year, and you don't need to feel anything for that to be true. Only one thing is necessary to experience God's power in your life, and it is this: recognition. Recognition is the only thing necessary. And so what I want to teach this morning, or my main proposition, is this. Christians who seek to experience God's presence need to know how to recognize it. Let me say that again. Christians who seek to experience God's presence need to know how to recognize it. Now, I have 4 doctrinal points this morning, and then 4 applicational points after that. My first point this morning is God with us in human form. God with us in human form. The Bible tells us that God became a man. This season, which we call the Advent season, is a season in which we pay special attention to that reality. This season, which we call Christmas, is a time in which we pay special attention to the baby in the manger, who was God in the flesh. Now, why did God become a man? Because the Bible tells us that as humans, we are sinful. We've broken God's law, all of us, and are therefore guilty of punishment, which is what the Bible describes as an eternal place called hell. So how can we be saved from the wrath which is to come? Who will save us? Can we save ourselves? Can we just ask God for forgiveness and say that we'll behave from now on? No, it's too late. The deed has already been done. We're already guilty. But thanks be to God that he chose to save those who could not save themselves. Out of sheer grace and mercy, he became a man just like us, and he lived the perfect life that you and I could never live in our place. And then he was punished on a cross in our place, not for his sins because he didn't have any, but for ours, so that God might forgive us because our sins have been washed away. God looked on our helpless world and said, not only will I help them, but I will become a man and I will dwell among them. In the Old Testament, God dwelt among his people in what was called the Shekinah glory. Now Jesus is that glory which dwells with his people. B.B. Warfield once said, Jesus was the glory of God, the Shekinah according to the Old Testament. The Shekinah was the visible manifestation of the invisible God. The Shekinah was a radiant cloud or a brilliant light within a cloud that signaled the immediate presence of God. For Jesus to be identified with the Shekinah was to be equated with the presence of God himself. In Jesus, we see the full manifestation of the majesty of God. When Christ was born in Bethlehem, that is why the angels sang, glory to God in the highest, and so should we. We are always in God's presence. The key is to recognize it. Now, point number two, God is with us in divine sympathy. God is with us in divine sympathy. On top of us needing salvation, we also need God's sympathy as we live this Christian life, which can be extremely difficult. In Jesus, we find this as well. He is our great high priest who is able to sympathize with our weaknesses. This is actually another reason why he became a man. His path in life was made as rough and difficult as ours is. He had just as many enemies as we do, if not more. His temptations were as fierce as ours, and for 33 or so years, his cup of sorrows was as bitter and as full as ours is. Isaiah 53:3 says, he was despised and forsaken of men, a man of sorrows and acquainted with grief. And like one from whom men hide their face, he was despised, and we did not esteem him. This is why we call Jesus the suffering servant. Because the way he obtained victory was through suffering and humiliation. This is one of the mysteries of the gospel, that in order for one to be exalted, he would first need to be brought low. This is completely contrary to human thinking. Even the children of Israel could not understand this. That is why they rejected Jesus as the Messiah who was to come. They were expecting a Messiah who was more like a demigod, like Hercules. One who would come in power to save Israel from their enemies and to establish the kingdom of God. But instead, Jesus was born an innocent babe and would be a humble servant. There was nothing special about Jesus' physical appearance. Very different from the Messiah Israel wanted. So mighty that he would come to kill their enemies. They would cry to him, kill our enemies and establish the kingdom. But instead Jesus said, I didn't come to kill them. I came to die for them because I love them. Jesus is truly Emmanuel, God with us, and can sympathize with our pain because he himself felt it as a man. We're always in God's presence. The key is that we need to recognize it. Point number three, God is with us in redeeming love. God is with us in redeeming love. In Jesus, we find love that is so amazing, it's so amazing as it is undeserved. We already talked about how all men are sinners and do not deserve God's love, grace, and mercy, but that God chose to love us anyway because of his grace and mercy, and it was completely undeserved. But this was not just any old type of love that he had for us. The love of God is often more radical than we often imagine. We often think of God's love, or we equate God's love with how he blesses us, right? With how he gives us gifts. But this is wholly incorrect. The most powerful form of God's love is the love that he had for us on the cross, which is what we call redeeming love. That is, when he sent his son Jesus to die for our sins, that is the greatest display of God's love that there's ever been or that there ever will be. Romans 5:6-8 says, "For while we were still weak, at the right time Christ died for the ungodly. For one will scarcely die for a righteous person, though perhaps for a good person dare to even die. But God shows his love for us that while we were still sinners, Christ died for us." God has proved his love for us in such a way that we can never question it. Can you imagine if a person told you that they love you so much that they would die for you, and then they went ahead and did it? Would you ever in your life question that person's love for you? Then why do you question God's love for you? Why is it that when things aren't going your way in life, you question God's love? Why do you forget what God has done for you when trials come? You must remember in the dark what God has already revealed to you in the light. In the face of all your doubts is the love of God perfectly displayed on the cross of Calvary. It is the love of God that we are reminding you of at the table when we say to you, "This is his body, bloody and broken for you." We are always in God's presence. The key is to recognize it. My fourth and final doctrinal point is this: God is with us in heavenly glory. God is with us in heavenly glory. All of us need a Savior. All of us are in need of sympathy. All of us need love. And in Jesus, we have all of that. Another thing we need is hope. And in Jesus, we have that as well. Jesus told us that he went to prepare a place for us in heaven so that where he is, there we may be also. The book of Ephesians also tells us that in Christ, we are already seated in the heavenly places. Our assurance of making it out of your life and being in paradise one day, very soon, is as good as done. That is God's promise, that we will be with him now and forever. We already have his presence, now recognize it. And now for my four applicational points, these are four principles to turn to when you get lost in the lie that you don't feel God's presence. Okay, the first thing is this: preach to yourself. Preach to yourself. Preach God's truth to yourself. Say, "I know God is with me because he promised me that he would never leave me or forsake me, and God does not lie." Number two, examine yourself. There is no such thing as not being in God's presence. However, there is such a thing as quenching the Holy Spirit and stopping God's activity in your life. And the way to do that is to live in unrepentant sin. And so sometimes God will stop working in your life in order to get your attention. And maybe he's trying to get yours. Point number three, ignore yourself. You know that in many instances, success in these types of things is simply knowing the difference between talking to yourself and listening to yourself. You need to talk to yourself and not listen to yourself. Talking to yourself is what I mentioned earlier as preaching to yourself, confessing and affirming truths to yourself. The other thing, listening to yourself, is what you need to stop doing. That is that little voice in your head that continues to tell you that you're no good, that God doesn't love you, that he's left you, he's abandoned you. That is what you need to start ignoring. My fourth and final point, reposition yourself. Many Christians are in a position where they're open season for the devil. I mean, they're just being tore up from the floor up, beat up from the feet up, because they just will not put themselves in a position where they can be protected. Rather than being in a position where they're in a church, accountable, with godly friends, godly people in their lives to encourage them and speak to their lives, instead they're out there alone, isolated, and it's free season for the devil. You need to reposition yourself this coming year and get yourself plugged in. Now, recognizing that God is already with you is the key to experiencing God's power in your life. Nothing can be a substitute for recognition. My God, I bless thee that thou hast given me the eye of faith to see thee as Father, to know thee as a covenant God, to experience thy love planted in me. But my faith is weak and wavering. Give me boundless grace for this, I pray, till I am in your everlasting presence. Let us pray. Heavenly Father, again, we come in your presence, knowing that you are here, you are an omniscient God, you are an omnipresent God, you are all-powerful, you are the God who hears us, the God who is not distant from us in any way, shape, or form, for you are transcendent and far above all things. You are still imminent, very close to us. We are very near and dear to the children of God. And so, Father, we simply ask, Lord, that as your children, you would bestow upon us the promises of your word, which is peace, joy, love, happiness, and all the rest. I pray this for each and every single person now. In Christ's name, amen.
Amen. Thank you, Pastor Chris, for a very meaty word. And I want to remind you guys that the same way that Christ came to us and Christ will come again, Christ remains with us. And every single sermon, every single Sunday, we draw your attention to the Lord's table. Because when you come to the Lord's Supper in faith and in trust, you will meet Jesus now. The last night with his disciples, he had the most intimate meal with them ever. And he says that this bread, this represents my body that was broken for you. As Pastor Chris said on the cross, Christ demonstrated his redeeming love. And we get the bread to prove that. As he said, this bread is my body broken for you. And in the same way, he gave us the cup and he said, this wine, this juice here, is my blood that was shed for you. It's his blood that atones for our sins. You will never be able to save yourself. I will never be able to save myself. It's trusting the completed work of Christ on the cross. So friends, every Sunday we invite you to come forward. But hear the words of the institution of the Lord's Supper. The Lord Jesus, in the night when he was betrayed, he took the bread. And when he had given thanks, he broke it and he said, this is my body, which is for you. Do this in remembrance of me. In the same way, he also took the cup after supper, saying, this cup is the new covenant in my blood. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me. Listen to this. Or as often as you eat this bread and drink this cup, you proclaim the Lord's death until he comes again. And we proclaim his death because in dying, he was raised. And that's what gives us faith. Not just that he died, but that he raised from the dead and that he prophesied way before that it would happen. But this is such a special meal that it's not for anyone. The word says also, therefore, whoever eats the bread or drinks of the cup of the Lord in an unworthy manner will be guilty concerning the body and the blood of the Lord. So therefore, let a person examine themselves before they come and partake. So family, take a moment, and if you have any unconfessed sin, please give it to the Lord right now. Repent and prepare your hearts to be able to come and partake of the Lord's Supper. Amen. Take one more minute to do that. Holy Spirit, you already know what's in our hearts. You know what's in our minds. You know those things that we've done, those things that we've thought about doing or actually didn't think nobody knows about. You know what they are. Take our sin, nail it to the cross. Give us faith that we might meet Jesus at this table. In Christ's name we pray. Amen. Friends, I said this meal is for all those people. If you have placed your trust in Jesus, this is for you. If you have given your life to Christ, this is for you. If you haven't, we want to know that you are loved, and we are so glad that you're here. And we'll be happy to answer any question you may have after this. We would ask that you refrain from coming to the table. But for all those who have trusted Jesus as Lord and Savior, please come forward. We will offer you the bread and say, this is the body of Christ broken for you. We'll give you the chalice. The blue one is wine. The white one is juice. We'll take this as the blood shed for you. You will drink, dip, partake, and go back to your seats. Amen. On the way up, the baptismal font is right here in the front. Because your identity is not in any mistake you have made. Your identity is having been baptized in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. So please feel free to run your hand to the baptismal font, and then come partake in the Lord's Supper. Amen?
Amen.
Family, please come with joy and gladness in the name.
Thank you.
the altar and receive this final blessing from the Lord. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine on you and be gracious to you. The Lord lift up his countenance on you and give you peace. And after the doxology, you may go in peace.
Peace, brothers and sisters. God bless you all.